Today on the show, Radical Ones, we continue our video game summer with 1995's Mortal Kombat. It's time to get radical.
It has begun!
This is where I start to have fun.
Well, excuse me, Princess.
My name is Alice. I work for the Umbrella Corporation.
Day Bison graced your village was the most important day of your life. But for me, it was Tuesday.
Fatality.
Shadow Demon, you shall not pass.
Hey! Paisanos, it's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
Finish him!
Welcome back, Radical Ones, to another episode of the Radical Retro Rewind Podcast. As always, I am your host, Radical Ryan Hunter, here with Rob, the movie geek himself, and we are back for our next round. Ooh, I like that. Next round, Rob, of video game movies.
Yay. Yes, good pick this week.
This is a movie I figured Rob and I were going to get to at some point before the whole video game idea. This was definitely going to come up because I feel like, Rob, Mortal Kombat from 1995 is one of those quintessential 90s movies that everyone remembers. Everyone has feelings about it. And I feel like a lot of good, especially researching, Rob, a lot of people love this movie, which I'm very happy to say.
Would have been perfect if we did this in August, because the anniversary is on the 18th, but...
Oh, so we're ahead.
We're a little ahead, but it's still good. I'm glad that we got this in.
You know what? In August, we will have to have everyone replay this episode and celebrate that anniversary.
Round one, fight!
In each of us, there burns the fury of a warrior. In every generation, a few are chosen to prove it.
One of you three will decide the outcome of the tournament.
Three strangers will travel to the mystical realm of Outworld to defend our people against Shang Tsung.
You will die.
And his forces of darkness. In an ancient tournament. One more victory.
Your soul is mine.
And our world
no!
is theirs.
It has begun.
The movie is described as Lord Raiden handpicks three mortals, federal agent Sonya Blade, monk Liu Kang, and action movie sensation Rob Johnny Cage, and he mentors them. After intense training, he transport the trio to the Outworld, the site of an interdimensional fighting tournament. There, the three humans must defeat the demonic warriors of the evil Shang Tsung, or allow him to take over the earth. Okay. Where do you want to begin?
An interesting description, because so I remember Shang saying that he, that, you know, Sonya was chosen and whatnot, But every time you turn around, he's like, oh, it's got to be Liu. It's all Liu. Liu Kang's the one. Liu Kang's the chosen one. He's the one that's going to help. One of the three of you will decide the fate of the world. I'm like, it's always been Liu. It has always been Liu. I mean, I guess the other two were there to make sure Liu got to the finals. But like, help me out here. It was always Liu. So I don't understand this whole like choosing.
Totally agree. Play.
But again, like I said, if it's all in the bigger picture, it definitely took Sonya to, you know, take out someone, and Johnny took out two. So if that is what it meant to get Liu to the end, fine.
Johnny Cage, I challenge you.
No, you'll fight me. I am Liu Kang, descendant of Kung Lao. I challenge you to Mortal Kombat. Do you accept or yield?
I accept.
Liu fought some unknown katana for no reason and then ended up in the final. I mean, he did do Sub-Zero, but I'm just saying, it's like, I think Sonya and Johnny did way more work, but yet Liu's the chosen. I thought, look, it's fine, but it's just the description is hilarious saying it this way.
Even Rob, during the whole entire time of rewatching, when Raiden, like you're saying, is mentioning the one of the three of you is gonna, you know, You knew which one of these people were a monk, which one's brother was directly killed by this person. Like, who do you think? So, okay, I love this though. So you're trying to, like, in a way saying, like, they were there, get him through. And you know what? If the two of them die, we still got, you know, real stars.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I gotta say, you know, I've always loved this movie. It is one of my favorite video game adaptations. I definitely played this game when I was younger. I don't play it so much now, but this is a movie that will forever be sort of that, for me, start of the trend. I know we've had movies before, but this is one of those movies where it's actually hopeful and possible to create a great adaptation to a video game, and that there are video games out there that can be adapted, and this is really that first one. It held number one forever until,
which is crazy,
you know,
which
until
is so,
you know,
crazy
Pokemon like knocked it out. But that's Pokemon. Like, Pokemon and Mortal Kombat, come on now. Like, it's
huge,
been the one forever. So yes, this one's been remade. I don't think we've gotten any other remakes just yet.
No, we've gotten cartoons. We've gotten the TV show thing that was a few years ago. And
but I mean, just like with other, you know, video game movies, I think this one had a remake. I don't know if anybody else has gotten a remake yet, except for like maybe Super Mario Brothers, if you count that, but it wasn't live action. So like,
that's true. It's like completely.
Yeah. So this is still in the ether. That's the thing. That's what I'm trying to say, is like, you can't get rid of it, and we're only going to welcome more. It can only get any better, like better. Yes, this movie is great.
So you set up one of my things I wanted to bring up. The director of this, of course, famously, is Paul W.S. Anderson.
And by Paul Anderson in this one, he didn't do the W.S. yet, but yeah.
You're right, Rob. I was looking at this and I was like, wait, when did he add that W.S.? So Rob and I have done Resident Evil. Matter of fact, in a few weeks, Rob and I are doing the sequel to that, which, remember, that was one of your, if not the favorite one, that was the one.
That's another franchise that got remade already. Let me make sure to include that. I did get a remake. Was it before Mortal, though? I don't think it matters. It's not a competition.
I think it was, actually.
But anyways, yes, anyways.
He kind of, I guess, got this. He did so well on this that the bar was, like you said, raised. And then when Resident Evil comes along, okay, it turned out that, and I think we might have mentioned it on that episode, that he wrote a script called The Undead, and he kind of just added umbrella things in hopes that they would take it. If not, he was going to make his own thing.
Yeah.
So what happened, in a way? Because, okay, Mortal Kombat, like you said, is like the perfect adaptation, really. If you think of, there's some things, even the way it's shot, that it looks like it's supposed to be the screen on the game itself. Mm-hmm. So he started so well with these Resident Evils that it got so far removed at some point. So I say give him only a few. You know, he can't take you all the way through, but he'll start you on these movies.
Yeah.
This was the man. This is the man.
Yeah, I still have a lot of faith in Paul Anderson. If anything, I think he definitely takes risks. He knows his audience as far as which games to pick.
And, evidently, yeah.
These are games that we definitely want to see. So, you know, I don't mind them. And, you know, if he did it again, you know, like I would give it a shot. I don't think he's like someone
that Monster Hunter, right? With Mila, which is another game, but I never played those games.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, notice that is not on the list of this summer. So I saw this, Rob, I figured by the time I was 10 years old, but you know, it was a different time. You went in with your parents. As a matter of fact, I saw this with my best friend at the time, his mother and my mother. Now, I'm sure that they were thrilled beyond thrilled with this movie. Me and my friend were so excited. I mean, and that soundtrack, Rob. But these characters, I gotta tell you, I was not expecting them to still give me so much joy. I will say, and I don't know how you feel, Miss Sonya Blade is giving me Christy Real from Charmed for our charmies out there. The woman gives the most stank face. I know what you did last summer.
All right, tough guy, you want to get
off?
No, do you?
Hi, Johnny Cage, and you are?
Where's Kano?
I don't know who you're talking about, but I'm sure I can help you find him.
Out of my way.
Just another starstruck fan, huh?
I never realized she was so serious until this time around. Oh my god, the woman. Did she smile? Okay, maybe once? Twice?
She did towards the end, but I think it was from other people's expense. Like, you know, if something bad or embarrassing happened to Johnny, she would definitely smile. No, Sonya is great. Bridget Wilson is just great. Like, people really don't understand this woman's career in the 90s and early 2000s. She was in a lot of stuff.
And sang. I had no idea until researching this. She sang?
Yeah, no, she was truly an it girl. And if anybody, I would say she was someone's awakening in Billy Madison. Or Last Action Hero, one of the two. Like, the woman was
so on good.
Fire. She's so good. But just, you know, being in the horror genre as well, like, she is legit. But for me, you know, Radical Retro Rewind, our show can talk about all of her popular movies, but the one that stands out for me is her performance in Love Stinks. I think that's the name of it, with French Stewart and Bill Bellamy, Tyra Banks. No, it's not called Love Stinks. I forget the name of it. I know what it is, but that might be one of my recommendations. Anyways, where she played a psycho, like, stalker slash girlfriend who was obsessed with being married.
I need to find the name of this.
It is so good, but she is psycho crazy, and she is so good at it. It's just an amazing performance from Love Stinks. I knew it. I knew that was the name of it. So yeah.
Yes. Oh my god, this cover. Yes.
Yes. So good. So good. So good. Yeah, I was definitely excited when this came out. The movie couldn't have come out in the best time. My brother just got me into MK2.
Perfect.
Yeah, he and I were obsessed with playing this together. Anytime we got together, we would just compete against each other all night. Like, we would not stop and just constantly play this game over and over again. So all of these characters, all of these faces, their backstories, all of it was fresh in my head. All of the fatalities, all of the other, you know, things, fresh in my head. And then this trailer came out, and I'm really trying to think of a trailer. Well, there's been plenty, but seriously, this Mortal Kombat trailer is one of the best hyped trailers I've ever witnessed.
Truly.
Especially in a theater. You were introduced to that banger of a song, right? That's not even a part of the game. Like, this is literally created for the movie. And when you hear that song in the trailer, yes, like, that's it. Every advertisement had this song. And so you go to the movie, and that's the first thing you hear. Like, insane. I was grinning so hard because I was just so excited. But it was also a movie that I could like geek out on. Like I was surrounded by other people that knew about this and was into this. Like it was just like a very big community movie for me. And even watching it the other day, you know, just the opening sequence of like amazing. And that's the other thing too. It's like when people are like, oh, the New Line Cinema logo, what movie do you think of when you see this logo?
Freddy versus Jason. I'm just
yeah, I know, right? It's Scream, it's Final Destination, and it's Mortal Kombat.
Mortal Kombat. Like, Mortal Kombat.
The for me, the advertisement was everything, but again, it just couldn't have come at a better time. I was so happy to see all these characters adapted, and like I remember it paid off so much when I was younger.
And that song that you mentioned, I feel like it became like club hit even, like singles. People who didn't even see the movie would love that song. A lot of people don't realize that it comes from the movie. It has nothing to do with the game. Like, that was not the game's theme song.
This exactly
is what made it popular. So, and like Rob was saying, when you get the title and that music,
it's a symbol, like it on the big screen, like it's insane how cool it is. But then right after this banger, we get Holes. Already Holes in the story that I have questions about, which is not a bad thing. But no, overall, I still really love this movie. But we get a vision of Chan, Lu's brother, younger brother, fighting Shang Tsung and unfortunately being defeated. And, you know, you've got the dream of Shang pointing at Lu, you'll be next.
That.
Your brother's soul is mine. You will be next.
And then he wakes up. But my thing is like, he's never seen this man. He doesn't know how the fight went down. Is this his interpretation? How is he able to know what Shang Tsung looks like?
Yes.
Help me out with this dream. Is it a prophetic thing?
That's
he doesn't
exactly.
even have, does he have that kind of gift? I know that he meditates, right? But like, still,
the monk.
You able to like witness that?
Okay, so I actually thought of the same thing, Rob. And what I came up with was that was sent to him on purpose, almost to get to him enough that he would come to the Mortal Kombat tournament.
So some magical thing did that.
Yes, that's what I think. I think Shang Tsung sent it with that. I cannot. That close up is still so amazing.
He's so good at that. I mean, you give a give anybody a catchphrase and they'll turn it into magic. Like the pointing, that tilted like upward in his eyes, like he was so good at that.
The zoom in, and then when it turns into a skull, it's like, holy crap. But yes, what a dream.
Mm-hmm.
What a dream. But yes, Rob, I do think that's the only thing that explains it. Or like you said, it's plot holes galore, and we're bound to get many more with this. So that's bam. We set him up. He's a monk, and there was no doubt, like Ryu said, there was no doubt in my mind, not even first watching this, that he was not going to be the one at the end fighting and saving the day.
Also, being a descendant of Kung Lao, I will be completely honest. I don't remember that line at all, because I know in the remake, they made it quite clear that they were related.
Yeah,
they fought together. But in this one, I don't remember them ever mentioning Kung Lao's name. And they said it twice in this movie. And I completely forgot that they actually paid attention that those two are related. And so I was actually really happy to hear that, because they did their homework. And I just don't remember them mentioning Kung Lao before. So it was just surprising to hear.
There was a few things in this movie I forgot that happened, even though it was one of those ones that I felt like it was on all the time, or I even would seek it out on Blockbuster and rent it all the time. Okay, so our next character, we mentioned her, Sonya Blade. She is out to avenge her partner, and this woman...
We didn't get to see the murder. All we can do is just blindly just want her to succeed with her attitude. But I love it. She's determined. She's got... And first of all, I'd be like, if I was Jax, I'd be like, well, my drag.
Yes! Exactly! Exactly. Exactly.
Like, my bad. I'm sorry. I'm not, you know, somebody that can fill the shoes of this partner, but like, you got you a, you know, a thing. I want to say that she's in leadership too, which is such a horrible example about following orders. She's clearly acting in a sense that she has no responsibility whatsoever. But I mean, I don't want to hate on her because I could say that about a lot of the other characters in this movie. But like her status and just her responsibility in leading a team, I would never trust her on a mission because of her like anger. Like this has got to be checked. Yeah, she just jumps on a boat, no backup. She has no recon. Like, why make her an army vet, if not a vet, but like a person in the military?
Yeah, like a special, she has some kind of training.
She didn't need any of that only because of the fact that she doesn't follow any of its rules or like mantra. Like, it's so insane how far removed she is from this based on her vengeance.
Yeah, she acted like this was normal everyday occurrences for her. Like, okay, this happened. I still need to kill this guy. Yeah. I don't care. Like, okay, good for you.
I was this a part of her backstory in the video game?
Honestly, this movie has shaped so much of the backstories of these characters for me. Like, that's all Sonya is. Her and her partner. That's her. That's all she'll mention. Partner. Oh, so that's her partner.
It's an honor to finally meet you, Sonya. Shang Tsung, at your service.
I'm looking for a murderer. He boarded this ship.
I'm impressed. But it is my boat, and if you'd like a tour, I'd love to give it to you myself.
Hey, be nice to the lady. She's just doing her job.
When I want backup, I'll radio for it.
No, but she's awesome. She's giving Patrick Swayze in Roadhouse with her kicks. She's all about the kicks, giving us Chuck Norris.
Love her leg thing when she
wraps
her leg and like so cracks good. Those necks.
Didn't even break a sweat. But she is said to be mimicked from a specific fighter that I read about. Cynthia someone. I'm not familiar exactly who she is. I should have looked more into her with that. But they...
So you mean like her style of fighting is actually based on someone?
Well, you can say that some of these, if not all of them, were sort of based off of... Like Johnny Cage was supposedly sort of a inspiration of Jean-Claude. Because they wanted him to do it,
which is my god.
Cynthia Rothrock is her name. She's a martial arts
Her, yes, I know who you're talking about.
The likeness of Liu Kang is Bruce Lee, Johnny Cage, you know, Jean-Claude. Like, they really went in, you know. Even, well, we'll get into this later, but Raiden, right, there's a little bit of controversy with him, but
a lot I gotta say about Raiden.
There's a little bit of a likeness with everyone. And so, I like the character of Sonya. I thought that she held herself very well. I think that she was, you know, I don't want to say that women are always trailing behind, but you know that saying, like, keep up with the boys and whatever.
Yes.
Like, she wasn't somebody that I thought stood out or had a disadvantage because she's a woman. I thought she still held her own. But they did kind of turn into a damsel towards the end. I thought that was so messed up. They should not have done that.
Her hair too, Rob.
Shang Tsung's like, oh, I'm going to fight Sonya and win this competition. I'm like, and then everybody said, oh, you manipulated and you know, trickery. And I'm like, why? Sonya's not a you know, formidable person. Is that what you're saying? You're going to take the easy route? Is that what you're saying? Even Katana was giving him shit. It was like, oh, how dare you pick a woman to battle at the end?
Sonya Blade, I have something for you, my dear.
I don't want anything from you.
On the contrary, I have something you want very much. You can thank me later.
I really enjoy Sonya. Unfortunately, she was not my favorite in the game. Now, you would think, right, because of our gayness.
I used to use her.
Really? I think that's great. For some reason, out of all of these fighting games where I would always choose women, I just could not kick it with Sonya like that. I don't know. Maybe it was just the way she was fighting. I don't know. I just wasn't feeling it. But all the other women, yes, definitely. But like, I couldn't.
You didn't like her green leotard outfit or whatever she's in?
I don't know what it was. Maybe I was like, nope, that's not an excuse. I did Chun-Li like forever, so that's not an excuse. I don't know.
I used to use Johnny Cage too, actually.
Yeah.
Bridget Wilson was given the name of Robo Babe by Paul because she performed all of her own stunts, including fight scenes.
Love that. But I will say this. I'm so sorry, Bridget. I love you so much, but Cameron almost did this.
Yes. Because of a broken wrist injury.
I would have loved to have seen Diaz's Sonya Blade. I mean, just think of what we got from Charlie's Angels. You know, she would have killed this.
And likable. Not that Bridget isn't, but like likable.
I would love to see that. I would love to see it. I'm so mad we didn't get that. But Bridget, you are queen. You know, you are first action star. Come on now. We love you.
But I would as well see that in an alternative world, because that would have just...
Yeah.
Okay, so we mentioned him. Johnny Cage. I was all about the cage.
Oh, Johnny Cage.
Goro's never been beaten. You go up against him, he'll kill you.
Well, if I don't, then he'll finish us off one at a time. If I challenge him now, I can finish this.
You're making this all sound really simple. And it isn't.
Yeah, it is. Because I can't let what happened to Art happen to you. Not to you.
Oh, don't you dare do this to protect me, Johnny Cage.
Trust me. I got a plan.
Oh, I can't believe this. You are the most egotistical, self-deluded person I have ever met.
Yeah, well, you forgot good looking.
You know, that humor, the glasses, I always just loved him. So, you know, when the sequel happened and I got in my seat and the first minute, I mean, we won't go into it, but I was pissed off.
Did you find out why he left?
Yes, well, he read the script of the sequel and turned it down.
There you go.
Is it because, I don't want to give it away, but...
Yeah, but that's why, because it only happened... he would have only gotten like 2 minutes.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, what do you want? Like, I wouldn't have done it either. You better get some somebody else to do that crap, because I'm gonna
replace Sonya too.
Poor thing.
Got a guy with things coming out of his hand. We got another guy who freezes stuff, and then there's a man who, as far as I can tell, is made out of electricity. I mean, how did he disappear like that? What is going on here? Who is this guy?
Let's just think this through. There is a rational explanation for this.
He's Raiden, god of lightning and protector of the realm of Earth.
Oh, great.
Oh, there's your rational explanation.
Listen. What you're about to face is vastly more important than your ego, your enemy, or your quest for revenge. You have embarked on a sacred mission. You have been chosen to defend the realm of Earth in a tournament called Mortal Kombat.
Defend it from who?
Your world is but one of many realms. One of them is a forsaken land called Outworld, ruled by an immortal who has crowned himself emperor. Now he seeks a new world to conquer and enslave.
Now wait a second. If this guy is so powerful, then why doesn't he just invade us?
To enter the realm of Earth, the emperor's demon sorcerer Shang Tsung and his warriors have to win 10 straight victories in Mortal Kombat. They have won 9. This will be the 10th tournament.
A handful of people on a leaky boat are gonna save the world.
Exactly. The essence of Mortal Kombat is not about death, but life. Mortal men and women defending your own world.
Why are you telling us all this? What about the others?
They are all great fighters. But I have looked into their souls. And yours. One of you three will decide the outcome of the tournament. The fate of billions will depend upon you. Sorry.
What about Shang Tsung?
Oh, still concerned only with vengeance? If you challenge Shang Tsung now, you will lose your life and your soul.
He is gonna pay for my brother's death.
You're not ready. Look. It has begun.
Okay, Christopher Lambert as Raiden.
So here's the thing. A lot of people look to Johnny Cage as the humor and the comic relief, but I think Raiden got the best lines and also was funnier than Cage. Cage just got more part. Right? Like, he just got more lines.
Yes!
Raiden, every time he would do something, it would make me laugh so hard. And I think it's because he chose to be, you know, unserious for such a god, right? Like, this is what I love about Christopher Lambert's Raiden, is that Raiden isn't human, right? Like, he's a godlike form. And, you know, who knows what he even looks like outside of that fleshy thing that he has on. But the thing is that he loves humans so much that he's taken on so much of their sort of slang and way of just their way of like talking and everything. And his humor and body language speaks volumes that he is obsessed with humans. He loves how they operate.
Yes.
And he just mimics a lot of that sort of like relatability amongst audiences, right? Like, he's not, you know, all stiff and walking like I'm a warrior first and blah, blah, blah. Like, he is,
yes,
like, you know, he's the don't you know, like, he's cool like that. And I that's what I like about him and his humor with this.
I don't think so.
Because I think Lambert is also known to be very serious. Now, I didn't really get into the Highlander stuff.
No, me either.
So I don't know if he was very serious in those movies, but I'm sure it was a very nice, refreshing way to see him have fun with this.
Agree.
With that being said, what do you think about the humor and the amount of it that was used in this movie in contrast with how serious the game was? Do you think that the movie should have lowered the humor in this such of like action movie sort of, you know, headspace that we were supposed to get in? Or is it understandable that you would put jokes and a little bit of humor,
right,
within a movie versus a game? Because we can get into the seriousness of the movie in itself, especially just being PG-13, which is
exactly,
it's not great. But like, should we have removed the humor and kept it very serious and real with these fight scenes? Or is it okay that we got a little bit of laughs while watching an action film?
I wonder too if that's because part of our 90s movie charm, where everyone had to have a one-liner and, you know, yeah, everyone had to have a humor. But yeah, Rob, I think that's what it is. I think it was the PG-13 aspect, and this is a way of making something also presentable to outside sources, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So those mothers and fathers that were dragged along or whatever to the theater, I think that's what the humor was for, and to offset some of the violence so they could say, oh, well, look, it's funny too. But it is strange, because when you do look at the game, it's like, wow. Even that the fact that you're right, that they got PG-13 and they really didn't show blood at all. I mean, it was, I guess, that lava kind of thing.
Yeah, the scorpion really got messed up. But yeah, outside of that, there really wasn't much bloodshed.
I think that's what it is. I think that's what it was. The thing I love about Raiden in this movie, which is odd because I feel like, and again, in that sequel, Annihilation, it
yes,
was like the character swapped like that. And it's literally the same exact moment. I like the humor in those moments and the awkwardness, like that laugh like I was making fun of earlier. I think that's hysterical because it is someone trying to fit in, like you said, like a god trying to like be down on this level and going, yeah. This is so funny. Mm-hmm. So I do enjoy his humor over even like a Johnny Cage, like you're saying, because it is funny and it is, I think it helps because you want to like the person, right? That's in lead of the good guys.
Mm-hmm.
So this is another way of going, look at this guy is cool. Although it is, it could be presented as cheesy sometimes, his acting, but I get it.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, his lightning effects, some of the CGI is just not holding up because you could tell that they were like so excited to have this CGI at the time.
And let's preface that, you know, this podcast definitely supports Mortal Kombat. It's 90s. You know, cinematography and special effects. Yes. But we are self-aware of what it is that's been given to us at this age now. And, you know, like we're going to talk about it. But this is not us, you know, bringing the movie down. When you watch this movie, you have to remember it does come from the 90s. And let me just say that you deal with the cards you're dealt with. And I think that they did the best that they could for this movie and what they were allowed to do as far as, you know, visual violence and whatnot. So I didn't mind it. I thought the lightning stuff was cool. I would have wanted to see more clear-cut lightning rods rather than just this glowy yellow and blue sort of thing.
Yeah, it's like a wave of lightning.
Yeah, I mean, or at least just have, because I even remember in Ghostbusters in the 80s, like Zool was covered in lightning bolts all the time, and they only did that with his eyes in this one. So I don't know what happened there, but it is what it is.
You know what's funny, too? We did Lost in Space a few months ago, and I brought up the CGI on that. Now, that was, I want to even say, a year's after this, and I think the CGI in Mortal Kombat looks better. So the only thing that just, to this day, I still don't understand what they were doing with Reptile.
Watch her carefully, Reptile. Keep her away from these humans.
I didn't understand it at the time. I don't understand it now.
Well, it's just sort of, I mean, do we, okay, well, I think this might be just a lack of information, right? So, I mean, if we really understood Reptile's background, it probably could explain it, but they just decided.
Oh, like he does this? Yeah.
Well, I mean, him changing into the sort of human-like Reptile, that is a little confusing. I don't know how that happened, but I think it's understandable that he started off as reptilian before getting into a human counterpart. Because I believe in the game, he does have a lizard face if you take off the mask.
This one kind of reminded me of, I feel like there was a PlayStation character of like a gecko. And it looked like that.
Yeah.
Not very reptile, but whatever the case is, this is so crazy. So then they finally get to the, you know, the tournament and everything. The synopsis says after, what did they say? After intense training. Honestly, I don't know how much training they got because there's a lot of cutting.
It's more of the mental training that was given to them. They needed to be able to like get out of their heads, get over themselves, and know that the fate of the world is resting on them for their little, you know, missions that they've got, right? Like, you know,
your partner, Sonya.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, revenge. And, you know, Johnny wants to prove himself and Lou is just, you know, on revenge as well. And it's just like, let go of your petty shit and really think about the big scope of what's going on. And that was their training, I think, is what he meant.
Okay, that makes so much more sense. I love that the warriors, right, are gathered in this space. Rob, I don't know if they used all of the money on sets, because this is like gorgeous sets. Even this dining room set, the food. Oh my god. And then I laughed hysterical, Rob, because they come in out of nowhere. They're sitting at these tables for a second. There's so much food all of these, they look like military-esque, kind of like assassins, whatever, part of Shang Tsung's.
This is like steroid-induced Foot Clan. That's basically what it was.
Minions, when they have their face covered.
Yeah.
Cover the face. It could be anybody. Literally, they come down, they flip these freaking tables over, and he's like, this is a taste of things to come. And I'm like, the food, what was the point? Like, for these people, even, they don't even get a last meal. Forget about it.
Welcome. You're here to compete in mortal combat. Tomorrow morning, the great combat begins. Some of you will even have the distinct honor and pleasure to face Prince Goro, our reigning champion. You are all witnesses to one of the greatest turning points in the history of your planet. Treasure these moments as if they were your last. And now for a taste of things to come.
That food, I hope you took something before we started, because damn, I loved that moment. And then I will say too, that part made it like a video game, because Rob, you didn't know every scene if you were going to the bathroom or you were all of a sudden going to enter a fight. It seemed like it was random.
Yeah.
It was the craziest thing. Craziest thing, how you entered one way and then all of a sudden it's like, fight. Okay. But I got the biggest kick out of it because of just things like that. So should we set up the emperor's adopted daughter who lived 10,000 years?
All right, let's talk about it. What is this? This is Talissa Soto. Is that her name?
Yes.
Talissa Soto. We love her. She's great. I did not get the katana that I wanted. Unfortunately, we didn't get her until part two. But this katana, we didn't get katana. She wasn't even in her signature outfit.
No. Nope.
Like, there was just no point in Katana's role in this, unfortunately.
Just to be beautiful and walk around.
Even that, I mean, I'm guessing she was a love interest to Liu Kang in this. I mean, they didn't really, you know, stipulate. It's just by default, we need to be paired with someone. But she took a liking to him and tried to give him, you know, some pointers to get through the game. My thing is I don't understand the Mortal Kombat rules that had them two fighting. And first of all, they didn't even finish the fight. Like, who won that? And then you also got her giving these cryptic clues. I'm like, woman, you could have just said water. Why you got to be cryptic? I don't get why you are playing games with him.
Whispering.
Element that brings life. I'm like, are you talking about spunk right now? Or are you talking about, what are we talking about here?
I would never have guessed.
I would never, that just, you know.
If you won't fight with all of your heart, there is no hope.
Why do you care if I win or lose?
To win your next match, use the element which brings life.
What?
Katana!
Remember my words.
Katana! That's enough!
You disappoint me. Not very wise.
But like, Rob, what is the element that brings life?
Why can't you just tell me water? Just tell me water. And what is that? Why was that water bucket even there? Well, no. You know what it was? Nope. I think Raiden set it up. Raiden put that there. I remember he walked in and set it down. He did. But still, what the hell, man? But I don't know the rules. I was just
very confused. That's the thing, Rob. That's the thing. The fight was never finished. It was so random. It felt like it was unofficial. And Shang Tsung is literally going, that's enough, Katana. You're right. She could have just said water as opposed to all of this, because she said it anyway, in a way. And he kept saying, don't say nothing. Oh, and this, and you got to conquer your fear. But like, she could have just said, like you said, okay, there's going to be a bucket of water. So
also, do you think this was cheating on Raiden's part? Because you know Shang Tsung couldn't do nothing outside of the rules. If he deviated at all, he would get scolded. But this man literally put the answer to his death out in front of Liu. Like, I wonder if that's considered cheating. Leave it to America.
Technicality. Maybe he was sick of him trying it with those goons like we were talking about, and he finally put the finger with the lightning, like, oh, no, you can't do that. Yeah. But it was so random, you're right, what rules counted, what didn't count. And then there was parts with flawless victory. Do you even have a flawless victory? That just pissed me off.
That's enough.
Excellent. Flawless victory.
Yeah, I will say that once the tournament started, it was nonstop fight after fight after fight. They did not give us a break. They didn't slow down. They didn't convolute it with a lot of like dialogue and all the exposition. Like, it was time for the next match.
And next round. Yeah, it's like a game.
I really loved about that. And I think this is why this is one of those great adaptations, because that's all the game was. They were just fighting. You set up the fight, why they are fighting each other, and then you go at it.
Right.
That's all we needed. And I picked it up this time that honestly, they just kept going. And I really enjoyed that. You know, they didn't take a break or anything. Let's just get to the next one.
Round two, fight.
Do you think that's why it's highly regarded as a great adaptation? Because it literally is the game pretty much with a little substance?
I mean, as the games go further, they had more cutscenes and more storyline to tell. And I'm sure all of those stories are wonderfully told. But if I'm going to go to a movie and I'm just going to have people, you know, standing around talking all the time and not fighting, like, that to me is not Mortal Kombat. I came here to see all of the special moves. I want to see all the fatalities. I want to see all the characters do their thing. So that's what I think is a big plus for this.
Oh, yes. And the sets again. So when we get, I feel like it's right after this whole ordeal on the beach where she said about the life, we cut to Johnny Cage. And the tree background, Rob, is still gorgeous to this day. I remember that as a kid.
Yeah.
It really does look very strange, and it's just gorgeous. And then we cut to, what was it, that room with the cobwebbed ladders and staircases everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it looks like you're in these weird sets that you would see in a video game or a level.
Yeah, it was very good. Very good. Scorpion definitely had a nice lair, and it was fitting. All of that was great. I really enjoyed that.
What did you think about literally using the voice clips from the game for him?
Get over here!
Love
like,
it.
But it is cheesy, right? I mean, just to hear like randomly like... But
it's too iconic. Like, you had to put that in there. There was no other way that you could do it. Let me just say also is that as simplistic as their costumes were, they were to the T on point with how they looked in the game.
Truly.
When these fools walk through that door, I about lost my mind seeing those bold colors and those costumes of them walking out, getting into formation. I love that entrance so much. It was so good. And this was also great is that Shang pointed out that they are enemies, but they're slaves under his power. I don't remember that line either, and I'm glad that they pointed it out because they are not supposed to work together. And in the sequel, you saw that Subby was good, or that specific Sub-Zero was good.
Oh, yes, it's different. That's right.
It was a different one. But yeah, we remember them as enemies, and so it was good that they put that line in.
Use the element which brings life.
One thing I love about this, though, as if anybody's going to go into this movie and not know who these people are, notice how they all had to find ways to mention who they were. Just drop a name every single time. And the worst one was Kano, who, you know, was in the club watching Sonya, and he turns around and he goes, I love punctuality in a woman. don't you, Shang, Mr. Shang-Chi. I'm like, first of all, you don't need to say his name. You know who he is. I know it's for us.
Right on time. I love punctuality in a woman. Don't you, Mr. Shang-Chi?
But it was just like everyone got that treatment. If you just appear for the first time on screen, somebody had to say their name. I'm like, we know who you are.
It's like the exposition dump.
It's so funny. It's so funny.
Well, Sonya Blade.
I really love their entrance. It's one of the best moments in the movie for me, I think. And as far as their special effects, the scorpion hook could have been a lot better. But the ice
is it alive? It's supposed to be alive in this?
It is alive, yes.
Like a snake almost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sub-Zero's effect I thought was great. I love the way that he was summoning it. Like, it wasn't just this easy, like, bam, bam, throw ice. Like, he had to really call, like, I liked all of that, so I thought that was great. So,
what did you think about the photo with the autograph falling for Johnny Cage after that?
Oh, so no, we can get into it. Let's point out as many as we can how much we found. So, Johnny Cage, he did a shadow kick.
Yeah,
he did his splits and punch thing, which was brilliant.
So, and it, again, it delivered a little comedy when he did a groin shot.
Raiden hit that dude's shoulder and was like, yeah! And I was like, Raiden is so funny. I love him. And then he's like, I'm sorry. But like, he did that, and then he did a friendship. A friendship. Who does friendship? I do friendships.
That's you?
Doing friendships. In the game, I love doing friendships. I think they are so funny, and I do because everybody does fatality, so I'm different, and I just do friendships.
I could never get fatality.
When they made a point to put a friendship in this movie, thank you. And I seriously turned to my brother. I was like, oh my God, that's friendship. I've done that. I've done the picture thing. It was just amazing. I love that they did that.
And what is Sonya's, there's a name for that thing that she does when she handstands and she does the neck thing.
She's good about the throws. She's good about her kicks. So she definitely got that. Part two is when we got her other signature fatality that we didn't get this time. Yeah, Johnny Cage got a lot of his signature stuff. We got Liu Kang, and he did his bicycle kick that we love so much.
Did you almost miss the sound effects, though? How he does that high-pitched thing?
That would have made it real cheesy. Yeah, there's no way he could have done that.
It would have been so over the top.
Not good.
But that's what I was waiting for originally, because I was like, oh my God, yes.
But they gave him a lightning bolt instead of a fireball, which was different. Fine. It is what it is. So I like that. You know, Raiden does his teleportation. Love that. I thought that was great.
Goro, when he comes.
Goro, I think, was great.
Is it time?
Yes. We've let these humans win enough.
Okay, yes. That's practical. See what practical does when it holds up.
And our Predator guy, I think, was our Tommy or Woodford or whatever I think his name is. Yeah.
Yes.
So, yeah, he got to do that. But no, Goro is known. Do you remember the trick in the game? In and out. Remember that was a thing.
Yes, yes.
You punt and you get out. Yes. So Johnny was like in and out, right?
Yes.
But the time to go in is when he's gloating and you know, cheering and being
exactly.
Very, and so they did a lot of that. Goro just kept cheering himself on. And that is when you attack. So I love that they kept that true from the game.
I do not fail.
So how is it again that they can do all of these things and literally doing a proper adaptation? You're saying down to the clothing, and then still nowadays, I mean, we can mention the reboot, but now everything has to be so gritty and dark, and we hate colors and we can't have anything like that. Like, you're right. This was the standard, I feel like. And you get it right once, I guess.
Yeah. I thought this movie did a wonderful job for what they had. And, you know, given, you know, just how cheap looking the first one was, the video game, like, I think this was a great step up to what, I mean, they only had seven characters, just seven. And we got 10 in this one because they mixed a little bit of part two.
Like you said, it was the perfect time. They had just come out. And
with the exception of Kano, we almost had all of them in the same room because they were all down in that boat. boat area. Oh, I was so mad that Kano wasn't present, but that would have been so cool to have them all in one room like that.
And that actor of Kano, what is his name? Trevor?
Yeah, Trevor Goddard, I think.
Goddard, yes. He was in JAG, and I am still to this day, that man, he passed away, and then I remember being a kid when he turned out it was an accidental something. Originally, they said it was, you know, something else.
Yeah.
But I felt like he had such a bright future ahead of him, but he is damn cheesy in this movie. Oh my God. The way he acts in this.
He definitely pulls off that vibe for sure. They mentioned that, I mean, I don't think this is true. I think it might be reaching or just sort of a theory, but yet his likeness was a little bit of Terminator with the red eye and everything. And so they kind of just pulled from that a little bit.
You're finally learning, Liu Kang.
Kitana.
Come with me.
What happened here?
The same thing that will happen to your world. Unless you prevent it.
Just to go back to Goro really quickly, they kind of, the only thing that people do bag on this movie for is they say he doesn't really move because it was only animatronics on the top arms. And he does a lot of punching.
Which is fair, but do you want Goro to look like Reptile with that gelatin-like CGI? No. I was completely satisfied with what we got. When that man lifted Art Lean with two hands and then did his signature bow with the other two hands, that shit was so beautiful. So beautiful. That's fine. Don't move. I'm totally fine with that.
I totally agree. And it showed his strength too, I think, Rob, that he didn't have to move everything. Clearly he's a huge man.
But it definitely would have been hard to do any signature move that he had from the game, for sure. I understand that is very tough.
But what a face. It really does. The face looks great. I was so impressed with even the eyes, the emotion it showed for animatronic.
And then our voice, who's been in everything. The man was working even back then, playing iconic characters. Mr. Kevin Richardson, God bless him in that deep octave voice of his.
Voice of a generation, really.
Yeah, it was so good.
Final round, fight.
This, I think, is going to be a little different for us because I love to bring up Robert Ebert, right? And Siskel. Could you ever guess, out of all the movies that they have hated, that Siskel said that this is the best video game turned into a movie? Okay, this is 1995 at the time. And he says the movie is often sensational and the special effects are amazing. And he enjoyed it. And Ebert says he's right in the middle and noted that fans might be disappointed in some of the killings being less brutal than the notorious violent Mortal Kombat. But he did admit that it was better than he expected. Honestly, out of the things that we've said, brought up with these two over the years, Mortal Kombat that they kind of liked is just shows you the testament.
I think that, you know, you have to really look at it from a gamer's perspective. And even if you can't get with it, you have to realize the beauty that this movie brought from adapting a video game onto the screen. There is just no escaping the fact that this movie had something going for itself. And, you know, while, you know, we could sit here and be like, oh, if we had the right technology, but like I said, they did exactly what they needed to do for the time that they were in. And it just made sense to keep it simple and the way that they did. The only thing that just sucks is that they couldn't make a rated R version of it, you know?
Ooh, right. Or an extended cut at the time. Because had it been maybe a few years later, we probably would have gotten the unrated DVD or something. But
well, you know, we were still dealing with video games are the devil, you know, sort of mentality. We're still dealing with that. So we had to take a little bit of the pressure off. And then we also had to deal with the idea that these kids wouldn't be able to go without their parents. And so it was really hard to sell a movie like this and make sure it made some coin.
And it made coin. The budget was only $20 million, and it made $122.2 million.
Pretty damn good.
So just to really quickly, before we wrap this up, we mentioned remakes. Of course, there was a Mortal Kombat, I want to say 2000, was it 20?
It was 2021.
I feel like it was years ago. What are your feelings about that movie? I mean, of course, it doesn't have to be, you know, it's clearly two different.
I was excited over the improved fighting choreography. I really enjoy the choreography in this one. In fact, I will say, I mean, I didn't really get your opinion about what you thought about the fighting and the scenes that we got, but Reptile versus Liu Kang was my favorite fight scene. I like Reptile whooped his ass. I don't care what anybody says. Shang Tsung was nowhere near Reptile. Nowhere near. Reptile whooped at like he, those moves that were in that scene were so amazing. I even love the Reptile.
So good.
Oh my God. When they did a name call for him when he formed. And then that music. Oh my God. It was so high octane. But anyways, the fighting in the reboot was so good. It was a lot better. It was bloodier. Yes. And the character likenesses were a lot better as well. I did really love the mystery on if we were going to have this guy merge into his Johnny Cage role, because they kept it ambiguous if that's who he, because he was the only like quote unquote white human in the game. And so it's like, oh, are we merging him into this character? I love that aspect. I don't like how they handled it, but I liked how they kept us on our toes with that. I don't know if I wanted so many characters in this one. There were a lot that they pulled from like 6 and 7 to be in this. And I'm just like, we didn't, I mean, I love the,
that
you know,
vampire woman, that vampire one who, by the way.
Yeah. Amazing. We love her. Yes.
But she does die.
Yeah. I know. If we're starting from the very first one, keep it to the basics for me. I wouldn't have mind more character development with some of these other characters. I love that Kung Lao was in it this time around. I thought the rating was great. Like, I think they did a lot of great things. There were just too many characters for me, especially if you want them to have sequels. Like, I need them to kind of slow it down and just rise them up slowly into this. But yeah,
because we even got that famous, the audience to identify with somebody. So throw in a cat like Cole, I want to say is his name. And I only remember that because it Charmed. Yeah. Cole, you're supposed to put yourself in the audience's shoes kind of, because he's into this world new and everything else. But you're right. There were so many characters that overloaded. So I think this, the 95 one might have, because it was only 2 at the time, like you said, they didn't overload it. Whatever the case is, maybe they didn't have as money as they do now, but
yeah,
that was so much better pacing wise because like you're saying, if there's going to be a sequel and you're killing off half of the characters or whatever the case is, what's the sense?
Yeah, they're just bringing more, I guess. But I mean, I did enjoy that. We got a lot more backstory. It was great that the movie started off with, you know, Scorpion's story or whatnot. So like, there were reasons to root, good and bad, and I just can only hope that the second one will bring more carnage and more fatality, you know, stuff, and just have it just be, you know, fun.
That's what I think, Rob. Fun. That's I had more fun with the 90s ones. I mean, besides nostalgia, I think this one is more of a blockbuster, cheesy, you know, whatever, over the top. And the other one's very, you know, trying to tell a story and serious.
I've been waiting for you. What took you so long?
I guess you knew it would end this way.
Didn't have a clue.
You humans are so unpredictable. I've got to tell you something. You guys did great.
So I did mention a little controversy with Raiden's character. So I wish that I could tell exactly, because for me, the game and the movie sort of blend together, and I didn't really play the game after part 3, so I don't know what they did with most of these characters, but they kind of changed them all around, and you didn't really know exactly which ones were full-on Asian characters versus we can do whatever. And so with Raiden being white, I don't think there was ever a depiction of him being from Asian descent because he is a god. So it could have been anything. And so I don't know if, you know, it was cool to like, I don't know if there was like a big backlash with that. But the other thing was, is that people feel that he was a literal carbon copy of Lightning from Big Trouble in Little China. But even the video game design of him was literally the lightning power, the hat, the like all of it kind of matched.
For sure,
that's Lightning. And yeah. Some people really had like kind of an issue with that because wow. Lightning is such a legendary character. I love Lightning. Lightning is my favorite. I have a Funko of him. Like, it's that serious. So there's a little bit of that. But I think somewhere in the game, they established that Raiden just was a white guy. But they made him Asian descent in the remake. I don't think it can go back and forth. I just hope that, you know, in future installments that we do have them doing the appropriate, because you just got to wonder, like, why weren't there that many, you know, Asian descent people in, you know, the first Mortal and stuff like that. And so I just found that to be really interesting.
His casting, though, as Raiden 2 is very out there. I would never, like you mentioned earlier, I mean, even the actor, on paper, I wouldn't put this as Raiden, because I always thought of Raiden in the video game mm-hmm. as Asian descent and yeah. also very serious, but Big Trouble in Little China. Holy crap. Totally, totally, totally. Radical Ones, out of all of the video game movies we're doing, truly, this one is, to me, is as fun as it was, maybe even a little more now that I'm old man, Rob. Just the fun, and you really escape for however, I feel like, is it an hour, even an hour and a half? It flies. I could say there's worse hour and a half you could spend watching something if you want a nostalgic journey. And Rob owns the DVD, so see? You got to get that physical media, Radical Ones, before yes, it's gone. Do.
Unfortunately, this movie is not free to stream. You can watch the reboot on HBO Max, but the first one you will have to pay for. I still recommend this movie if you ever feel like you have a theme night and you're like, what movies do we need to watch? Like, Mortal Kombat is just one of the best in that. And there were times where I'd watch this and I'd be like, wow, this really didn't age well. But then I watch it again and it's just like, I'm reminded why this movie is so good. And shout out to Robin Shu. Is that his name? Our Liu Kang.
Yes, Robin Shu, who looks amazing still.
Yeah, he looked great. Robin Shu, he was funny, charismatic. He was likable. He looked great. Oh my God, the flow of his hair. Jesus, like, yes.
He woke up beautiful.
Yeah. No, the man is sculpted to the gods. And he I've seen him in some like YouTube like interviews and videos and stuff. Still has a good spirit on him. There was a video of him and Johnny Cage, Lyndon Ashby. They both played their characters on an arcade and like played with.
Oh yeah. My God. I love that.
Yeah, you can find it on YouTube. It's really cool. It's really cool. I like that they're still talking about it. I like that he still appreciates the character. And yeah, I really enjoy this movie. So I'm glad this was on the roster for this summer.
That's right. He was also in Beverly Hills Ninja.
Yes, he was.
Oh my God, that's so crazy. Wow, another movie. With that being said, Rob, do you have any recommendations for us?
Rob's recommendations.
I do. Let's see if any of these are some hidden gems that you may or may not know. If you happen to like Mortal Kombat and would like sort of the same tone or maybe plot point or maybe just more martial arts, I have some titles for you. Keeping it retro, I want to talk about Running Man with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Running Man, yes.
In 1987. I picked this one because of its colorful characters and themes. It seems that every single person he fights has some kind of code name or theme, and not necessarily a power, but a strength or a certain skill yes. to challenge our hero. And it's done in a game form, so I thought that would be fun to watch. And it's a really good movie. They're talking about rebooting it. And I believe this is John Carpenter, right? Didn't he do this one?
Was it Stephen King? It was some kind yeah. of horror. It was Stephen some King. Kind of yeah. horror.
That was going to be my second guess. It was either Stephen King or John Carpenter, but yes, great film.
And it's perfect for now, Rob, too. Like, yeah. like you're saying, a reboot, this would totally make sense in our time of game shows and TV yes. things. Great, great. Yeah.
The other one, which I thought was a little darker, grittier, but yet still brings in some comedy, is the original Ninja Turtles. I think that this is a perfect even double feature with Mortal Kombat. I think watching these two movies together would be such an evening. So yeah, definitely do Ninja Turtles. There's also martial arts in there as well. And I'm sure just about the same type that you saw in Mortal Kombat, at least with Shredder.
Yes.
Yeah.
Great choice.
The last one that I have, if you did enjoy Mortal Kombat, is this little gem that people forget about. This is Eric Roberts. This is Best of the Best. This is 1989. So it was a group of friends who form a team of a region. I think they are representing America as well. And it's just sort of the up and down of being pressured to be the best in this sort of competition. It's a martial arts competition. And it's just a team of people who are just trying to do everything they can to win this tournament. And yeah, it's kind of the same form, but there's like corruption behind it. There's like, I think there's like a drug tie to it. Like they deal with some very bad people, like mobsters or whatever. So it's not just about like the competition. There's like behind the scenes stuff where they're just dealing with a lot of dangerous people. And a lot of people really just don't remember this movie as much. But I mean, when I think of Eric Roberts, I don't think of all the cheesy one-liners and
the newer stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, all the cameo stuff that he's doing. I think about Best of the Best. Like he was lead in this. He gave lead performance level acting. Like he was the star of this film, and the martial arts, if I remember correctly, wasn't that bad. So definitely check out Best of the Best. Now, if you did not care for the original Mortal Kombat, or maybe you did but you want something just a little bit more lighter,
right,
or you want to stick to the same genre but just go in a different direction, I have some lighthearted fun ones for you. I have a very soft spot for this movie, and I want to say that I may have recommended it before, so my apologies. It's straight to DVD, DOA, Dead or Alive. I will always,
always
stand by this movie. I don't care what anyone says. This movie is a gem. It is so funny. It's so cool. I love the fighting. It just makes sense to me. It's a great adaptation to the video game. I love all the stars that are in it. It just warms my heart every time I watch it. So DOA,
it makes sense. It definitely makes sense on this list for sure.
Yes. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. The next one is Kung Fu Hustle, which yes, I think is a wonderful martial arts movie, but it also has that gifts and powers element to it. And it's hilarious. It is so funny. Definitely an underdog movie. You'll see a lot of great effects, great fighting. So definitely check out Kung Fu Hustle. The last one I'm going to suggest is 1995, Jackie Chan. This is the one that put him on America's map, and Rumble in the Bronx.
Yep.
Yes, the man who did all of his stunts and just shocked the world to be able to witness it with our own eyeballs, that he did everything that you see in this movie. But it's a very big, triumphant movie. It just gives hero, and it just comes from Jackie Chan, who is a legend in his field. And I think anyone who enjoyed a little bit of the fighting style from Mortal Kombat, you're going to get that times two in Rumble in the Bronx. And, you know, it's 90s. So if you have not seen that, please watch Rumble in the Bronx if you do anything. It's not just about Rush Hour. I'm telling you, Rumble in the Bronx is so good.
It's so crazy. I feel like these were the same times in my life, because I saw this with the same friend, this mm-hmm. movie, this Rumble in the Bronx. Was it R-rated too? I feel like, yes. And that was a big thing we were telling people. We're seeing an R-rated movie because our parents are letting us.
Yes, definitely was R-rated movie. I think Best of the Best is also R-rated. Running Man, I can't remember. I think that's PG-13, but you can go back and forth on that one.
Yeah.
But yes, definitely check out those titles.
Great movies, Rob. Thank you so much.
Of course.
We have a full summer radical ones ahead. Again, this is one of the best video game movies, but we got a lot to cover. And look forward. I know that our first Resident Evil episode did really well, so I feel like there's a lot of Resident Evil fans out there. So if you like Paul W. Anderson enough, come back in a few weeks and you'll have him again. Rob, with that being said, where can the lovely people find you when you're not hanging out over here?
I have another page, Rob the Movie Geek, on Instagram, slowly but surely getting back into doing more movie reviews. You can catch sort of the archive that's on there right now, and you can find me here as well.
And the Radical Retro Rewind podcast, one word, on TikTok, Instagram, YouTube, and beyond. We've only just begun, and we will see you, of course, next Friday. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Retro.